Good morning. The Bible reading is from Revelation 21, verse 1. It's a long one, through to chapter 22, verse 5. And I'm reading from the NIV version. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell there with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death." One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and said to me, "Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." And he carried me away in the spirit to a mountain great and high, and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It shone with the glory of God, and its brilliance was like that of a very precious jewel, like a jasper clear as crystal. It had a great high wall with 12 gates and with 12 angels at the gates. On the gates were written the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. There were 3 gates on the east, 3 on the north, 3 on the south, and 3 on the west. The wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The angel who talked with me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city, its gates, and its walls. The city was laid out like a square, as long as it was wide. He measured the city with the rod and found it to be 12,000 stadia in length, and as wide and high as it is long. The angel measured the wall using human measurement, and it was 144 cubits thick. The wall was made of jasper, and the city of pure gold, as pure as glass. The foundations of the city walls were decorated with every kind of precious stone. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third agate, the fourth emerald, the fifth onyx, the sixth ruby, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth turquoise, the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. The 12 gates were 12 pearls, each gate made of a single pearl. The great street of the city was of gold, as pure as transparent glass. I did not see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives its light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. On no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun. For the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Sam, for that mammoth reading read so well. Well, before we get into the passage this morning that Sam has just read to us, I'll promise to take you back to verses 6 of chapter 20 that we skipped over last week. This is the 1,000-year period, the millennium, and it's caused a lot of division and debate in the church throughout the ages. And not a very easy passage to have to talk about, but I'm going to give it a go. The debate around this passage has been centered around the interpretation of how people interpret the chronology, the way that things are all put together in this passage. I'm going to try and be as brief as I can describe or explain these different views, and there are three. There's pre-millennial, amillennial, and post-millennial. Now, please don't switch off. This is, it's a little bit technical stuff. We'll try and get through it quickly, just so that we get this in place as we move into this next part of Revelation. So these terms refer to when Christ will appear within this 1,000 years that's talked about in Revelation 19, or chapter 20, rather. So for the pre-millennialist, Jesus comes before the 1,000 years. For the amillennialist and the postmillennialist, he comes at the end of 1,000 years. So we get that straight. Pre is before, a, and a means no 1,000 years. No and the post are is after, the end. So for the premillennialist, we are to read this passage in its historical sequence, how it's actually written in Revelation. And premillennialists read all of Revelation this way. I grew up in a Brethren church, and we had this often in our teaching, mapped out with timelines and charts that explained it all. This is a picture of an old version of that. I think this might be what we had when we were kids. And there were pages and pages of these. This is a more simplified version of what this is saying towards the end of that. The next slide. Thanks, Peter. So in a premillennialist idea where Christ comes early, Christ comes here. This is where Christ has been born. He's ascended. This is where we are now. Christ then returns. There's another resurrection of those who have been martyrs. And then they have the 1,000-year reign on earth where Jesus is king. Everyone sees Jesus as king during this 1,000 years. Satan is bound during this time. And then towards the end, Satan is released. There's a rebellion of Satan and his forces against this reign of Jesus on the earth. And then there's final judgment, the second the resurrection of all other believers. And then we come to what we're going to look at this, today in Revelation 21. So you can divide that section into Christ returns, Christ reigns, there's a final rebellion, and then the final judgment. Amillennialists, I'm going to stumble over this word, it's a hard word to get this right. Amillennialists and postmillennialists take the view that this thousand-year period is figurative. It's the age that we're living in now. It's a period between the first resurrection that's referred to in verse 6, which says this is Jesus' resurrection, and then the final judgment in verse 15, when Jesus comes to judge the world. So they would say this 1,000 years is a figurative period, the period that we live between when Jesus came, was resurrected, and when he comes back again in the second coming. And at that time, he'll come back, the resurrection of the dead will happen, and then there'll be this final judgment all happening together. So this 1,000 years is not a literal 1,000 years in their view, just like the other references we've seen as we've been going through Revelation of 7.5 years, or 7 years, 2.5 years, 1 month. They're figurative, not literal. So they would say this 1,000 years is not a literal 1,000 years. It's describing a long time. A time at this stage that's already past 2,000 years since Christ was resurrected. So the amillennialist view and the postmillennialist view are similar, except the posts say that this happens, this period after the Jesus, between his two comings, we can expect to see an increase in Christianization of the world, coming more like Christ, more like God's kingdom, God triumphing over society in this 1,000-year period. That view is not followed by many people today. So basically, we have two views: a return of Jesus, the resurrection of the dead, final judgment, all happening at some future event in time. That's the amillennialist and the postmillennialist view. Well, these views are events are happening in a future time, historically, as they are mapped out in the sequence that we have here in Revelation. And that's the main issue that people have with this passage, how we interpret it, what it actually means, what causes this division and this debate within the church, heated debate sometimes. I hope if we have different views this morning that we don't get that to that point of heated debate, even if we disagree. And with what I'm about to say, maybe it's just as well I'm leaving for six days for a month in Europe. Okay, I was brought up with this pre-millennial teaching of what Revelation says here, with these charts and timelines. But I'm now leaning more and more towards an amillennialist view, particularly as I've been reading and studying this series on Revelation, as I've looked at and read and tried to get my head around stuff that I've presented with you each week. The issue really comes down to how we understand the book of Revelation and the genre that it's written in. And we've talked about this a lot as we've been going through this series. If we read Revelation the same way that we read the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which are historical records, eyewitness accounts of what happened, putting it all in sequence. If you read Revelation the same way we read that, we will have a pre-millennial view of Revelation, and particularly this passage here. First, Jesus comes back in chapter 19. Then Satan is bound in chapter 20. Christians are resurrected, then Satan is released, there's a final judgment, and that's the sequence that we have if we read it historically, as it is in chapter 19. But as we've seen again and again as we've been going through Revelation, Revelation is to be understood primarily figuratively, not literally. As Andrew Satch points out, Revelation is about visions rather than eyewitness reports. This isn't history as John witnessed it. It's a vision sequence as John glimpses it and takes different views of this vision that he has. Throughout Revelation, we have this phrase, I saw, and I saw, and I saw. Now, if we think that means this happened, and then this happened, and then this happened, that's where we'll get the sequence of end times events. It happened in an orderly fashion. But the order of the events as they appear to John via these visions isn't necessarily a sequential order of how they happened, or how they will occur. We talked earlier, remember, about the seals and the bowls of wrath and saying that they weren't necessarily different cycles of the same thing, or different cycles, but actually the same cycle described in different ways, but giving a different point of view or different intensity of what these cycles were. Because there are difficulties if we read chapters 19 and 20 explaining events as they are sequential, one after the other. Instead, they seem to be overlapping pictures, the same thing, but overlapping. For example, in chapter 19, it ends with God's enemies cast into the fire. We get to chapter 20, the end of chapter 20, God's enemies are cast into the fire. Chapter 19 refers to this great battle, picking up some imagery from Ezekiel chapter 38 and 39 between these characters called Gog and Magog. These images appear again in chapter 20. It's referring to the same battle in both chapters. So this seems to be a case of overlapping chronology, or as Tom Wright, a theologian in the UK, describes it as John's confusing kaleidoscopic imagery. So therefore, Jesus doesn't necessarily have to come back before these events. Rather, Jesus' return is a culmination of these two chapters together. Another question, we're almost done with this technical stuff. Another question we has to do with the resurrection. Verse 5 describes this first resurrection. According to the pre-millennium view, martyred Christians will be resurrected, and then 1,000 years later, the rest of the Christians will be resurrected. Two different resurrections of Christians 1,000 years apart. And this is taken from verse 4 chapter 20. They came to life, that's the martyred Christians, and they reigned with Christ 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years had ended. That's a different resurrection 1,000 years later. However, those that follow the amillennialist view and the postmillennialist view believe this more naturally refers to Christ's resurrection and our resurrection. Our resurrection to life spiritually, not physically. And then the final resurrection is in the end time. There are two resurrections, only two, in Scripture. And we know when we read Ephesians, Paul talks about this. He says, Christ was raised from the dead. We were raised with him at that time when we believe in him, because it's a spiritual resurrection. And we look forward to a physical resurrection at the end. So that's a really big, a very quick Reader's Digest kind of explanation of a hugely complicated passage that would have taken a long time last week to try and cover that as well. There's a lot to unpack. And doing it quickly like that does not do it justice. And probably for many of you, looking at your faces, probably raises more questions than answers. But I hope it's given you some understanding of some of the complexity of how people read that passage, how you may have been brought up, how I was brought up, and how we've reached that understanding of what it means. As Tom Wright wisely says, we shouldn't be dogmatic over all of this. He says we must hold on to the central things which John has made clear: the victory of the Lamb and the call to share his victory through faith and patience. God will do what God will do, he says. And whether we're in this 1,000-year period now, or Jesus will come later and rule here for 1,000 years, and then we'll join him in heaven, if it's a future event, Wright reminds us, it is clear that the one who wins the victory is the Creator God, who does so to defeat and abolish death itself, and so to open the way to the glories of the renewed creation. That is what matters. So with that, let's change gear and let's look at today's passage, chapter 21. Maybe we'll pray before we get into that. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. At times it can be hard to understand. Thank you for giving us wisdom. Thank you for giving us men and women with greater minds that can help us unpack it. But Father, help us to understand it today, what we've shared this morning, what we continue to look at today as we look at the glories of this wonderful new heaven and new earth that you have prepared for us. So guide us through this, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we look at this chapter 21, the beginning of chapter 22, the key passage we're looking at in this passage is verse 5 of chapter 21. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Our world today is a different world than it was 10 years ago, than it was 20 years ago, than it was 50 years ago. But just imagine for a moment what it was like 500 years ago. Here's what England looked like 500 years ago. Most people got married in June because they took their yearly bath in May and still smelled pretty good in June. But they started to go off at that time, so brides carried a bouquet of flowers to hide their body odour. Thinking of baths, baths consisted of a big tub filled with hot water. The man of the house had the privilege of going first and enjoying the nice hot clean water and still hot. Then came the sons and other men in the house, then the women, and finally the children, and last of all, the babies. By then the water was so dirty you could actually lose someone in it. Hence the saying, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Most houses of that time had thatched roofs, thick straw piled high with no wood underneath it. It was the ideal place for small animals, cats, dogs, mice and rats, to live. When it rained, the straw would become slippery, and sometimes the animals would slip and fall off or out of the roof. Hence the saying, it's raining cats and dogs. See, you know all this history. This is great. The floor of the house was dirt. Only the wealthy had something other than dirt, hence the saying, dirt poor. Last one. Most people had little meat, but sometimes they could obtain pork, which made them feel kind of special. So when visitors would come over, they would hang up their bacon to show off. It was a sign of wealth that a man could bring home the bacon. They would cut off a little to share with their guest and would sit around and chew the fat. Now, there's quite a bit of dispute over the authenticity of those, or the things that go with the history was true, the little slogans that go with them. And I've got more, but I won't share. I won't bore that with you this morning. But there's no denying that things have changed radically in 500 years. We are living in a new world today than people back in the 500 years ago lived in. But that change pales in comparison to the difference between the way things are now and the way they will be in the new heaven and the new earth, the new Jerusalem that we are looking at this morning. So chapter 21, John writes, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. This is the final I saw phrase in Revelation. We've had this as we've been going through. They've been markers to identify, here's another vision that John has received from Jesus. This is the last vision. And it serves as a high point in the whole of the letter. It's a passage that we've been hanging out for as we've been going through some pretty challenging and hard and sometimes horrible passages as we've been going through this book. It's the conclusion of God's big rescue story. The story of redemption. A story that began way back in Genesis chapter 1. The future that Christians have been anticipating and putting their hope and their faith in all through history from that first century. Not the picture the world has of heaven being all these individuals sitting on clouds and playing harps. This is a new creation coming out of those heavens, out of the heavens, a holy city, the new Jerusalem. This new creation is going to have some things that are common to what we have now, some things that we will understand and recognize present in this world, but it's also going to be radically new in other ways. In her book, Guthrie describes it as God not making all new things, but rather all the things in this creation that have been impacted by the curse, by sin, are going to be restored, renewed, and resurrected. When we were stuck in New Zealand 4 months during COVID and couldn't get back, we watched a lot of TV, obviously, and they play a UK show called The Repair Shop. Australia has a version of that here. I haven't seen The Repair Shop since we went back here either. But it's a wonderful show where all these British experts in renovation are in this barn, and people come along and give them their broken family heirlooms or things that they treasure that are now broken, and they fix them and bring them back to new. Has anyone seen it? Okay, there's a few hands. The Aussie version or the British? Okay, British. It's an amazing show. God, the one who put things in motion at the very beginning, is going to renew and restore the wonderful creation he began in Genesis that was broken, by sin. He's going to bring all things to their intended end. One thing that's going to be different, we see in this opening verse, is there's going to be no more sea. In Scripture, sea is often a picture of chaos and danger. So this is referring to the fact that this place that God is creating is a safe place. It's a secure place. There'll be no danger. There'll be no chaos. In verse 4, we see there'll be no more tears because there'll be no more death. No more mourning, no more crying, no more pain. Let's look at that verse. He says, God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. I'm not sure there's a more tender picture of that of a parent wiping the tear from their child's face. Maybe you remember a parent doing that to you when you were a child, or maybe you've done that to a child yourself or a grandchild. Maybe you've wept recently over some pain in your own life. So what a comfort to know that God will eradicate these horrible consequences of sin, the effects of sin. No more death. We can't imagine what that would be like. No more death. No more pain. C.S. Lewis tries to capture this new but different, new but better creation in his book, The Last Battle in the Narnia series. And he writes this. Peter, said Lucy, where is this, do you suppose? If you ask me, said Edmund, it's like somewhere in the Narnian world. Look at those mountains ahead and the big ice mountains beyond them. Surely they're rather like the mountains we used to see from Narnia, the one up westward beyond the waterfall. And yet they're not like that, said Lucy. They're different. They have more colours in them and they look further away than I remember them, and they're more... Oh, I don't know. More like the real thing, said Lord Diggory softly. More like the real thing. The world is to become more like the real thing, the more like God intended it to be in the beginning, but even better. It's like everything in the original garden could have been as God could have become, as God intended it to become, but expanded, made even more beautiful, more wonderful. But it gets even better, because God isn't just making all things new, he will also be with his people at last. In verse 3, we see a voice, or hear a voice, come from the throne of God, announce that God's dwelling, his dwelling place, his tabernacle, will be with his people. The very beginning of the gospel that John wrote, the same John who wrote Revelation, his gospel, he describes the coming of Jesus. Emmanuel is the name he has, God with us. The Word, John says, the Word God became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Literally, he came and pitched his tent among us. In the new creation, God will permanently and forever pitch his tent among us, among his people. And John said, God himself, he emphatically writes, God himself. He's making a point, not just part of the Trinity, not just Jesus this time, but God himself. Our great God will be with us, with his redeemed people, and we'll be united with him for eternity. This is the future that we have to look forward to. A future in which God makes all things new. A future with God himself. And then we get to verse 9, and a familiar image reappears. Remember the seven angels in chapter 16 who had these seven bowls containing the seven wraths of God poured out on the earth? Well, they're back. One of them at least. Verse 9, one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and said to me, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great mountain high and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. This angel comes to John and he acts kind of like a tour guide. He takes John to this mountain and shows him this city, this new city that's come down from heaven, the city that is described as the bride of the Lamb. In other words, this holy city, this new Jerusalem, is the church, the community of the redeemed, the community in whom God dwells now with the Spirit, the community in whom he will dwell and who he will, among whom he will pitch his tent. And the verses that follow, John tries to describe the glorious, beautiful city that he can see within the limitations of human language. And you can imagine how hard that must have been for John to come up with words that would describe that. He says in verse 11, it shone with the glory of God. Its brilliance was like that of a very precious jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. It had a high wall, great wall, with 12 gates and 12 angels at the gates. On the gates were written the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. There were three gates on the east, three on the north, three on the south, and three on the west. The wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. So a massive high wall surrounds the city, so symbolizing the security, the safety of this place. And around the wall are these 12 gates, three on each side. And people coming from every direction is this image. People come from every direction to be part of this city. At the gate, there are 12 angels, one at each gate. Divine security guards to protect the gates. Even though, as we see, as we get down to verse 25, the gates are never shut because it's never night. Gates were always closed in ancient cities at nighttime, but there's no night in the city. The gates contain the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. The foundations of the city have the names of the 12 apostles written on them. You might remember when we went through the book of Ephesians last year, John wrote that the church is built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ himself as the chief cornerstone. So this city will include all of God's people, the Old and the New Testament believers, all those who have been redeemed by Christ. And there's verse 15. The angel who talked with me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city, its gates and its walls. The city was laid out like a square, as long as it was wide. He measured the city with the rod and found it to be 12,000 stadia in length, and as wide and high as it is long. Again, these descriptions are symbolic. The city is this perfect square, a cube actually, like a giant Rubik's cube that would stretch from Melbourne to Kalgoorlie in the west. A 2,200 kilometre square footprint. But not only that, it's 2,200 kilometres into space as well. It's a big city, massive city, 1,000 times bigger than the city that Ezekiel saw in his vision in Ezekiel 48. The only other place in the Bible that we see reference to a cube, a perfect square, that's also made of pure gold, is where? Remember where that is? It's the Holy of Holies, the holy place in the temple, and later in the tabernacle, and later in the temple, when God's throne, the place where God dwelt with the Israelites as they made their way through the wilderness when it was in the tabernacle, and then when they settled in Jerusalem, it was brought into the temple, and that was God's dwelling place. The place that only the high priest could enter, and then only once a year at the Day of Atonement. And if he entered without going through all the rules of what he was to do to enter that place, if he did that without following those, he was struck down dead. This was ground zero, the meeting place between heaven and earth. From verse 18, there's a list of 12 stones that adorn the foundations and the walls of the city, precious stones, roughly corresponding to the gems that were on the high priest's breastplate that he wore. So the New Jerusalem described here in chapter 21 is a representation of the ancient Holy of Holies. Only now, the city is the Holy of Holies. Not just a cube of 20 cubes, or 20 cubits, or 10 meters square. Now all of God's people across all the ages, from every corner of the world, will be gathered together and infused with God's presence, as if they were the Holy of Holies. And that's why we get when we get to verse 20, John says, I did not see a temple. I looked, I couldn't see a temple. Why? Because we don't need a temple to God in this New Jerusalem. Its temple, verse 22, is God himself, God Almighty and the Lamb. So the temple of the old ancient Israel represented God's presence. But in this New Jerusalem, believers now have God's presence. It doesn't need representation, they have God's presence. What we're learning here is this New Jerusalem is a picture of the church, as we will be. We'll be God's one people. People from across the ages, from every tribe and nation, in whom God is dwelling. The same way he dwelt in the Holy of Holies in the Old Testament. Again, C.S. Lewis tried to express this prospect of experiencing God in this way in his book, The Weight of God. He says, we do not merely want to see beauty, though God knows even that is bounty enough. We want something else which can hardly be put into words, to be united with the beauty we see, to pass into it, to receive it into ourselves, to bathe in it, to become part of it. At present, we're on the outside, the wrong side of the door. We cannot mingle with the splendor we see, but all the leaves of the New Testament are rustling with the rumor that it will not always be so. Someday we shall get it. It's a beautiful description. One day we will be forever in God's presence. That's the future followers of Jesus have. And then we get to chapter 22, and we see that this city, this temple city, is not just a city, but it's also a garden. I won't read those passages, but we had that read to us before. But the first three verses of this chapter gives this image that sounds very much like the Garden of Eden. There's also imagery drawn here from Ezekiel chapter 47. The Bible began with a garden in Genesis, and it's going to end with a garden, this garden. John sees a river flowing through the garden. In Ezekiel's vision, this pulls imagery from, Ezekiel saw a river flowing out of the temple. But here, there's no temple, because as we've discovered, God is there, doesn't need a temple. So this river is flowing directly from God's throne, actually from a shared throne of God and the Lamb. And it's described as the river of water of life. We head back to John's Gospel, chapter 4. John records the story of the Samaritan woman. And she was looking for satisfaction in life, looking at every place she could find, looking in all the wrong places. And then she has this interaction with Jesus at the well. And Jesus offers her living water. He promises her water that will truly satisfy, that will quench her thirst forever. And in verse 14 of chapter 4, John writes, or Jesus said, "Whoever drinks the water I give, they will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." This spring of living water is now flowing freely through this city, and we'll be able to drink from it abundantly. And on each side of the river, there stands the tree of life. The last time we heard this tree mentioned was in the Garden of Eden. Remember, God was afraid when Adam and Eve had eaten of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that they would eat this tree of eternal life, and live forever. And so he banished them from the garden. But here in this new garden, there's not one tree, but there's two on both sides of the river to show that we can always have access to it. They'll be available always, right throughout the year. Not producing just one type of fruit, 12 kinds of fruit. That meaning is lost in the NIV, but the ESV says the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. These trees, again, are a picture of eternal life, of abundance, abundant life. In fact, even the leaves of the trees provide healing, a picture reminding us there'll be no pain, no sorrow, no death in this heavenly city. We will be perfectly cared for, perfectly nourished by our God. Everything will be the way God intended it to be in that first garden. But now the curse is gone. One thing that's not in this garden that was in the first is Satan. He's now banished to eternity in hell. In his place is the very throne of God and the Lamb. There's so much more that we could unpack in these images. But the best image, though, is found in verse 4. Five words that seem almost too good to be true. In verse 4, they will see his face. They will see his face, God's face. Moses wasn't allowed to see God's face. Remember in the Old Testament, all they could do was look at God's back. All he could do was look at God's back. And throughout the Bible, people longed for that time when they would see God face to face. King David writes in Psalm 27, "One thing I ask from the Lord, and this do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all my days, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple." I don't know how many of you have been in a situation like this at an airport, waiting at the arrival gate for maybe family members to arrive, and you wait and you wait and you're watching the board, and suddenly the doors open and you see their face. We've been through this many times. Lots of tears have been shed at that place, that chance when we get to see those we love face to face. One day we will see our God face to face. We'll be in his presence and we'll be able to look at him, look at his face. For now, we see only a reflection of him like in a mirror, as John writes to the church in Corinth, as Paul writes to the church in Corinth. But then we will see him face to face. This is the future that awaits us as God's people. A future beyond our wildest dreams. A future beyond our imagining. We can't even imagine what this is going to be like. John has painted a picture for us, trying to capture this beauty and this glory, the magnificence of what he saw in this vision. But it'll be even better than what he wrote. As Christ's followers, as those redeemed by his saving work on the cross, God has put his name on us. And he's promised to bring us into his holy city to live permanently in his presence. So how should this motivate us as we head out today, go into the world, go into this new week that's ahead of us, as we head off to work, to school, as we go about our things we've got to do next week, this coming week? Well, first, may it motivate us to live faithfully and wholeheartedly for God as we wait for what he has promised for us. And second, may we do all we can to share with others, to tell others this good news that we know about the future. We have a message to tell the world and all its turmoil and strife and confusion and brokenness. This message is one of hope. It's a message of hope, of certainty, a future in the presence of God. Jesus has come. And he'll come again. And the new heavens, the new earth, are more certain than anything else that could happen in this world, even whether tomorrow comes or not. We don't know, but we know for certain that God is going to come with a new heaven and a new earth. God has promised us a place with him forever. And nothing will destroy that promise. If we really believe this, let's live in the light of it day by day. And let's tell this generation that so desperately needs to know this about what is ahead. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with our praise. We began with praise, and Father, we want to end with praise as well. Praise, wonder, awe, as we consider the glorious future that you have prepared for us. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this amazing vision here in Revelation of this new heaven, this new earth, this place of beauty and perfection. But most importantly, this place of eternity in your presence, where we will see you face to face, when we can be with you forever. We can only now just imagine what that will be like, as John has painted this picture of it. But one day, we will see and experience it in all its reality. Lord God, please keep us living in light of that great future, staying true, staying faithful to you, and telling others how they can be part of it as well. May our eyes be on the eternity that awaits us, even as we tread this earth now. Thank you, Father, for your promises and for your grace towards us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Could you please stand with us and sing the last song?